Thank you for choosing to watch this sermon preached at Heritage Baptist Church. Heritage Baptist Church is located at 1843 Peeksville Road, Locust Grove, Georgia, 30248. You can contact us at 770-320-7771. Visit us on the web at www.hbcga.com.
On your phone, you've got a calculator. Pull your calculator out. Need somebody to add. 200 people are going to add. Look, add this up for me, if you will. That'll be a blessing. Are you ready? All right. 678 plus 721 plus 739 plus 645 plus 653 plus 685, plus 715, plus 647, plus 754, plus 762, plus 707, plus 806. What is that? 85 what? 8512. All right. Now, with that number, just remember that number, all right? And now turn with me, if you will, to Acts chapter 5. Turn to Acts chapter 5. All right, Acts chapter 5, going to give you a good verse, amen. Everybody there? All right. Now, the Bible says in Acts chapter 5 and verse 40, and to him they agreed, and when they had called the apostles and beaten them, they commanded them that they should not speak in the name of Jesus and let them go. Verse 41, and they departed from the presence of the council, rejoicing that they were counted worthy to suffer shame for his name. Verse 42, and daily in the temple and in every house they cease not to teach and preach Jesus Christ. Especially verse 42, and daily in the temple and in every house they cease not to teach and preach Jesus Christ. If you're in a habit of underlining things in your Bible, you ought to underline those two words, every house. Every house. And that's what I'm preaching on tonight. I'm preaching on every house. You know what all those numbers were? You know what those numbers were a minute ago? There were 12 sets of numbers I gave you. Those are 12 routes that the postal service runs in Locust Grove. That means there's 8,512 residences just in Locust Grove. That's not counting the population. They say there's that many homes that are in Locust Grove. Now, that's not the businesses now. I didn't include any businesses on those routes. Those are stops that the post office makes in front of a house where people live. I was riding over here. I mean, of course, already been studying on this, and you can't help it. When I was studying on this, I'm looking at every single house, but not just looking at the house and wondering how many acres does it have, or how many rooms does it have, or how many bathrooms does it have. But I'm riding by thinking that every single house that we ride by, it represents a home with a family in it. Now, and we'll get into that in just a moment. There's another verse over in, you're in Acts. We'll go back here to Acts chapter 5, but go to Acts chapter 20. Go to Acts chapter 20 and look with me in verse 18. Acts chapter 20 and verse 18. And when they were come to him, he said unto them, you know from the first day that I came into Asia, after what manner I have been with you in all seasons, serving the Lord with all humility of mind, and with many tears and temptation which befell me by the lying in wait of the Jews, and how I kept back nothing that was profitable unto you, and have showed you and have taught you publicly, here it is again, and from house to house, testifying both to the Jews and also to the Greeks, repentance toward God and faith toward our Lord Jesus Christ. Now, it sounds like that in the early church, this matter of going house to house, I mean to every single house, that was the mode that they used to reach people. By the way, can I tell you something? That mode hadn't changed in the day that we live, amen? There's a lot now, boy, I want to use every avenue there is to let people know what Jesus did for them. On the website, we've got the plan of salvation up there. We've got gospel tracts printed, and we'll put them on cars and put them out, and I'll see them over at Walmart where you've left them over there. I mean, brother, they're everywhere, and I'm grateful. There's so many different ways to get the gospel out, but there's no substitute for the biblical method of you and I reaching people, I mean, one on one. You read your Bible and look at all the times when Jesus sat down with an individual just one on one. I mean, brother, when he talked to them, you know, the great, we read it and we'll quote John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Boy, we quote that verse, the children learn that verse. You know, that was preached one on one to one man. I mean, to Nicodemus. One man Jesus sat down with and gave that great verse that now our children quote and we use it. I mean, brother, in all of our curriculum, everything that we do. But do you understand the Son of God was taking time with that one individual? Yeah. But here in the early church, I mean, brother, if you read the book of Acts, you'll see just that. You see the Acts of the Apostle, the early church, what they were doing, how they were doing it. Brother, we look over in chapter 2, I mean, brother, and we notice a good pattern of what needs to be done. In Acts chapter 2 and verse 42, well, verse 41, and they that gladly received his word were baptized. And the same day there were added unto them about 3,000 souls. Man, people getting saved, people getting baptized, and people joining that church in that day. And they, here's what they did, and they, all of that crowd, continued steadfastly in the apostles' doctrine and fellowship, and in breaking of bread, and in prayers. And fear came upon every soul, and many wonders and signs were done by the apostles, and all that believed were together and had all things common, and sold their possessions and goods, and parted them to all men as every man had need. And they, there it is again, all of them, continuing daily with one accord in the temple and in breaking of bread from house to house, did eat their meat with gladness and singleness of heart, praising God and having favor with all the people. But notice what the Lord did. And the Bible says, and the Lord added to the church daily such as should be saved. Brother, every time I read that, I get under conviction. I've said that all of my Christian life, but every time I read that verse, and the Lord added unto the church daily such as should be saved. Man, I think if Brother Terrell Hopkins was where he ought to be, telling everybody he should about Jesus, couldn't somebody get saved every day? Amen. By the way, if we were where we ought to be, telling everybody we could about Jesus, couldn't the Lord have somebody saved in our life every single day? And the Lord added unto the church daily such as should be saved. By the way, how did that happen? They were going house to house, amen. I mean, they were telling everybody everywhere. As you read through the book of Acts, over in chapter, I believe it's chapter 3. Let me find it here. That was chapter 2. Over in chapter 4 and verse 32. And the multitude of them that believed were of one heart and of one soul. Neither said any of them aught of the things which he possessed was his own, but they had all things common. And with great power gave the apostles witness of the resurrection of the Lord Jesus, and great grace was upon them all. Brother, you read right here. I mean, the Lord, they had great unity, but they were all about doing the same thing. In chapter 5, it says it again. Persecution had come. At one time, they just spoke to him and said, don't do this anymore. Don't be preaching like this anymore. But now they brought him in and they have beaten them. I mean, brother. And they said, and by the way, and with a stern warning said, and don't you dare mention the name of Jesus anymore. Don't you preach him. Don't you teach him. Don't do anything. Yeah. Well, notice what this crowd did. And they departed from the presence of the council, rejoicing that they were counted worthy to suffer for his name. Amen. Brother, I know many a Baptist, they'd have packed it up, man. They'd have sat inside their house. They'd put tinfoil over the windows. I mean, they wouldn't even get outside. They wouldn't have done anything. They'd have been hermits from that day on and said, oh, man, somebody told me I couldn't testify. I can't speak in Jesus' name. Not this crowd right here. Man, this crowd right here said, I tell you what I'm going to do. I'm going to go tell it even more. And the verse 42 says, and daily in the temple. Man, they went down to the church where all the people were resorting to. They went down to the temple, but not only there, and in every house they ceased not to teach and preach Jesus Christ. Brother, that's how the word got out. Man, you read about the early church, and no wonder they had 3,000 saved at one time. No wonder they'd have 5,000 saved at one time. No wonder it said that the Lord added unto the church. Then later, the number of the disciples were multiplied. How did that happen? Man, they were going about to every house telling everybody they could about the Son of God. Now, with that said, with these numbers here, I started looking up some of these things. Now, the census was in 2010, but they estimate that they had an estimate I saw on the computer there. By 2015, they thought the population here just in Henry County would be over 217,000. All right, I mean, that's a lot of people. But then, you know, that's just in this one county. So I figure, if you add 2016, and did just a few years here, it'll be around 220,000. I mean, people in this, just in this one county that we live in. And now, I realize that some of y'all don't, everybody doesn't live in Locust Grove. Some live in Stockbridge. Some live in McDonough. Some live down in Jackson, down in Butts County. I understand that. But the thing is God's given us, a mode of reaching people. And here it is, this matter of going to every house, every house, every single house. Now, you may live on a road. There's houses on that road. Now, let me ask you, who lives on that road? Who lives in all those houses? We ride by them. Oh, that's a nice house there. Oh, I like that yard there. Man, they've got an RV there. Oh, they've got, that's pretty grass there. Man, that's nice there. Who lives in those houses? Who lives in every single house? See, the Bible says every house. And I believe what that means is that we have a responsibility, and I'll get into that in just a minute to reach them. But now you may live in a subdivision where, man, the houses are very close together. You may live in a farm where you got acres and acres all around you. I don't know where you live. You may live in apartments where, man, there's 30-something families packed in one little building right there. I don't know where everybody lives. You may live in an RV. You may live in a tent. I don't know. But I know this. There's somebody lives next to you. Somebody lives next to you. And the Lord put them next to you. Oh, that's a total accident where I live. Absolutely not, friend. It's a total accident that I'm saved and I live on this street and I live where I live. No, no, no. Not an accident at all. God put you there. God put you where you live. God allowed you to be able to have the means to be where you are, living where you are, doing what you do. And he understands. Some people live one place, and I mean, man, they live there, and they live there all their life. Is there anybody sitting here, you have lived in the same, or, well, your family, you live with your mom and dad, and you lived in the same house the entire time you were growing up. Did anybody do that? All right, a few of you did. Man, we moved around like gypsies. I'm telling you what, we moved everywhere. Up, down. I mean, it seemed like if I got a little bit of money, they moved somewhere else. I lived in one apartment complex, Newcastle townhouses over in Doraville, and we lived in three different apartments in that one community, man. We moved down on the bottom, up in the middle, up on the side over there. We'd make so much racket, we'd have to move somewhere else, amen. But just moved, just in that one place. I told him when I was little the other day, I was talking about growing up. I said, man, I grew up in a trailer park. My mama lived in a trailer park, and my grandparents lived right up on the top in another trailer up in the trailer park. Amen. And I'm just telling you, man, we lived in trailer parks all our life. I mean, you talk about mobile homes, man. I mean, we understood that. And it was just that. We moved all over. Well, you know what? People do that in the day that we live. All these neighbors you have, be careful. You may not have the same neighbor next week. You may not have you let a month go by, and I mean, brother, the entire population there, I mean, there's new people that have moved in. Work these bus routes a little while. You can go visit one week, and you've been picking kids up. You go back, the entire apartment is empty. Now, it'll be good. You may find them over on the other side of McDonough. You may find them somewhere else, but people move around a lot in the day that we live. But God knows that. God knows who's moving in. God knows where you live. God knows where, how long you're going to live there. He knows who's going to live next to you. He knows the people that are going to live around you. And with that in mind, that's why the Lord said, and daily in the temple and in every house, they cease not to teach and preach Jesus Christ. When I began to think about this matter of people, now, how long do you have them living there? How long are they going to live there? How long are those people not just going to live in that home? Let me ask you, how long are they going to live? When's your neighbor going to die? When's your neighbor meeting God? When's your neighbor going out into eternity? You know, I jotted this down. 1.78 people die per second. Now, I don't know how they figure that. I wouldn't want to be that one. I'd want to be like 0.78 dead. And then I could be, that mean I'd be like, you know, 0.22 alive, you know, or something. I mean, 1.78, how do they figure that, you know? But that's per second. That's 107 people a minute die. How long have I been preaching? 107 people a minute, 6,390 people in an hour go out into eternity. I mean, go out into eternity. They're breathing and living. Hey, they're breathing and living an hour ago, and 6,390 of them, they're not breathing now. They're dead. They're either in heaven or they're in hell. Boom! Like that. 6,390 of them every single hour. This day's gone by from the time you woke up, whatever time that was, and then all you got, let that 24-hour period come around again tomorrow morning, and 153,000 people have been ushered out into eternity. Now, you begin to do that. By the way, that's 56 million people a year. Now, I don't know that that's not going to be your neighbor. I don't know that that's not going to be the person three houses down from you. I don't know that's not going to be the person at the front of your neighborhood or the person in the back of your neighborhood. The person that you ride by every day, the house you ride by every single day on the road that you live on. I don't know that. What I want to get on your mind, though, is now you leave this church today, I don't want you ever to ride down this road or ride down your road or ride down another neighborhood and see a house and think about it the same way. You see, because inside of that house, here's what I think about. Write this down. The occupants of that house. The occupants of that house. Now, I'm not just talking about, is there a dad? Sometimes you got a dad, a mom, and children. You got an entire family, what they would call a complete family sitting there. You got dad, the dad, the mom. Then sometimes you've got a stepdad or stepmom involved in all of that. That's the way we grew up. Then sometimes you've got a single parent that lives in that home. A single parent that just is raising that child. Maybe a parent, maybe the spouse died. Maybe the spouse left. Maybe they got a divorce. But there's plenty of single parents raising their children and trying to raise them, just trying to raise them just like you're trying to raise them. Sometimes you go by a home and, man, there's grandparents that live in that house along with some of them. Or maybe a grandparent's spouse has died and they moved them in with them. I went today, was up at the hospital. Me and David went visiting, and we saw Miss Eleanor, Jeff and Natalie, Natalie's mother. They sit about right there, around about on Sunday morning, you know. Well, she's up there. She had a light stroke, and we need to be praying for her. She's doing well. She said, the only thing I noticed, they had me sign something, and I had a hard time. She said, I couldn't recognize my own handwriting. She said, when I had that stroke, it scared her. She said, that guy was down there yelling in my face, what's your name? What's your name? How many fingers am I holding up? She said, I wanted to tell him to get out of my face. She said, but I could hear what he was saying. She said, but I couldn't respond to it. She said, that was right afterwards. She said, when I could respond, she said, I told him, hey, you don't need to be in my face again like that, amen. And I was like, oh, she's doing better, amen. If she can't, hey, if a woman goes to fussing, she's feeling better, say amen. And no, not my wife. I mean, I saw other women, you know, that happens with other women. But Miss Eleanor, she's doing good, amen. And doing better. We're praying she's going to have to get out, and then she'll be 20 days in another facility, like a rehab, where they're helping her, getting her strength back and all of that. But just be praying for her, amen. But that's a different type of home. They've got them living there. Man, I tell you, I go by some of y'all's home. You got every family member you have living with you. Amen. I mean, brother, they're all over the place. I can go one week and there's one set of family. There's another set of family. You know how you fix that? Buy one of them little bitty houses they talk about now. Amen. You know, one of those small houses, you know, where they build it and you're like, bedroom, bathroom. I mean, you stay in one place. It's like a tri-county thing. I mean, brother, you can turn and I mean, you're in every room of the house right there. Nobody in the family will live with you. Whoa, amen. Right now, y'all about to sell out and go buy one of them small houses, aren't you? Amen. But I'm just telling you, hey, you know what? Hey, go to the Amish house. Brother, them Amish, they just build another room on. You know that? I preached up around Pennsylvania and all that. They will. They'll build another one, build another one, build another one. And I mean, it's unbelievable. You run up there, they got clotheslines running from, I mean, all the way across. And I mean, all these, same color shirt. I mean, just exact shirt all the way down through there. I mean, man, they don't change, man. That's some modest women right there, too, girls. I'm telling you what. I mean, son, and my wife said, oh, don't tell me all that. Oh, yeah. I'm telling you, modest women up there. Amen. But anyway, let me just tell you, I'm just talking about homes. I'm talking about in these homes, it's not just the dad. It's not just the mom. It's not just the children. Every single house we ride by, they're souls. They're souls. They're souls. A soul is eternal. This body's not. This body's temporary. This body is, it's only, I've got it while I'm here. The body dies, the body goes back into the grave. But the soul of a man lives for all eternity. A soul goes to heaven, a soul goes to hell. Now, God's going to give them a body there, I understand that. Not getting into that, not preaching on that right this minute. But I just want you to understand that they're souls. When you ride out of here and you leave, now, the mission house is out there, and right now we've got, Miss Tiffany and the kids, they're staying out there right now, and then when they're gone, then we'll have somebody else out there, and there's always somebody out there. So I understand that's a little bit different there. But what about the next house up there? That's the man that owns the fence company. I've met him. I've gone door to door. He told me he was saved. His wife said that she was saved. The next house, I've never been able to meet those people. I go down there and they've never been outside. I've knocked on the door. I mean, all the years we've been, I've been by there, I mean, I don't know how many times, bunches of times. Never met them, not once. The house after that, that's the Tweedales. Billy and all the rest of them. The house after that, the man died. I witnessed to that man. He told me he was not saved. As far as I know, he died, lost, went to hell. The rest of them, the wife and the rest of them, they've moved out of that house now, but that's the last house before you get to the corner down there. I don't want to just think, oh, that's a white house and that's a blue house, or that's the fifth house from the church. See, we've got to meet these people and we've got to know where they're going. We got to know where they're spending eternity. And the truth is, it's not just asking. I don't want to be satisfied to say, are you saved? Are you not? Do you know it? Has anybody ever? I would love to see everybody get saved. Because I realize that one of these days they're going to leave here. See, the occupants of that house, it's not, again, we got to get on your mind. There may be a full family there. There might be 10 people living in that home. There may be 5 people living in that home. But there are eternal souls that are hanging in the balance that are in every single one of them. That's the occupants of the home. By the way, what about the offspring of that home? What about the children that are running around? Man, I love going by. We run the buses and pick up a lot of the children, and we see a lot of them. But these families are not just families that are sitting. These are not just a mom and dad. It's not just the souls of the parents that are there. It's not just the souls of grandparents that may live in that home. Brother, inside of every one of those little boys and every one of those little girls is an eternal soul. Why do you think we run buses and pick up kids and bring them in here and tell them about Jesus? Why do you think we are everywhere? Why do we work on these buses I'm telling you, aggravating, working on them, and you put something in it, don't work, put this in, try. Hey, I'm just telling you, why do we do that? Why do we buy gas, and why do we buy insurance, and why do we do all of that? Because of the offspring of these homes. You see, mom and dad aren't going to ride that bus. They're just not going to get on a bus. Truth is, we may be their babysitter. I've heard people complain about the bus ministry. Well, I tell you, all we do is bring in them rough kids and they just do this and they mess up this and they do that. Yeah, I'm one of them. I was the worst of them. I messed it up. I was the ones that they should not have picked up. All right. But I'm pastoring church now, so the Lord's kind of changed things around a little bit. Amen. But I mean, hey, and I realize that. And if we're not running buses to keep pews clean, Somebody say amen now. Hey, we're not running buses to keep pews clean. I'm telling you, we're running buses because the offspring, those children, have an eternal soul inside of them. Somebody's got to reach them. Somebody's got to reach them. Hey, tell me another church that's going after them youngins. Come on now. Sounds like we are. So how important is it how important are the offspring of the homes in this area where God's put us? Now, I realize there's children everywhere. Preacher, there's children dying and going to hell in Africa. You're right. But the Lord hadn't put me in Africa. God didn't call me there. God called me to Locust Grove. Lord called me right here. This is where God put us. By the way, this is where you live. You live in Georgia, obviously, so you remember this church. You know, I wish everybody in Georgia was a member of the church. That'd be great. But you understand, you live here. I don't have anybody from South Carolina that's come down and joined the church just saying, well, we'll come once a year. No, they don't do that. The Lord had you in this area. You crossed paths and God put you here. So we are responsible, hey, for the offspring of these children that are all in this area. That's, you see, these homes, it'd be terrible for a dad to die and go to hell. And it's terrible that dear man up there died and went to hell. Oh, my goodness, that's terrible. I can't imagine him spending eternity in hell. But what about his children? What about his grandchildren? What about the generation that should come, those that'll follow him? You see, this matter of reaching people is not just a matter of, well, let's reach this family. Let's see. Let's add a number to the church. Let's put somebody else on a pew. No, it's keeping somebody out of hell. You know, if you keep a dad out of hell, hey, how many times I started reading down through here. You know, the Philippian jailer, he sprang in and said, what must I do to be saved? And they said, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and thou shalt be saved and thy house. Now, it didn't mean that if one man gets saved, that means, oh, if I get saved, then my family's saved. That's not what that means at all. But I'll tell you what it does mean. It means a lot of times that when that man gets saved, that family will follow suit. When that man gets saved, that family will follow suit. Now, it's a very rare thing, like the Bardens all sitting here. It's a very rare thing when daddy, mama, and son, I mean, boom, all get saved on the same night. But they did. Y'all remember that? Sitting around that kitchen table, amen. And daddy's not saved. Mama's not saved. We're talking to them. And Andrew's just sitting over there listening, amen. Wait a minute. I asked daddy about being saved. No, I'm not saved. You need to get saved. Yes, I need to get saved. And a minute, Miss Brandy, are you saved? No, I'm not saved. You need to get saved? Yes, I do. And Andrew, he's like, what about me? Amen. But Andrew didn't want to save either. So, hey, a whole family. It's rare a whole family getting saved at the same time. But I tell you what can happen. You reach one, you've got an open door now to reach whoever is in that family. You may win the daddy. You may win the mama. You may win the child. But I tell you this, God's got a hand in that home now. And the Lord may use that for us to be able to reach them. You see, how important is it? You see, it's not just the occupants of the home. And I think about the offspring of the home. Here's what I want you to realize. What about the opposition to that home? Now, they face everything that we face. Man, they go through, they have financial trouble, they have family trouble, they have, everything you can think of. Now, I mean, in the day that we live, man, they've got a million things that are trying to keep them from God, just like you have. But many of them, if they're not in church or they're not saved, I mean, think about it, their soul is pulled in a million directions. I'm thinking about this matter, this world that's around them. It's a carnival world, if you will. You know, that's where the word carnal comes from, that word carnival comes from that word carnal. But that when I say carnival world, I mean, man, we live in an entertainment world. And these people they're going to be pulled with that. It doesn't surprise me when I ride by on a Sunday morning and there's the whole ball field is packed with families. They got their kids and boys and girls out there playing ball and they're not at church. It doesn't surprise me when the world does that. Now, when God's child misses church to go play ball, something's wrong there, amen. I mean, come on now. I mean, we know better. Say amen. But here, that's where you get people mad because then they're like, oh, preacher, you're preaching against my children. You're preaching against me spending time with my children. I mean, that's how I... All right. But I'm just telling you, I expect that out of the world. There's things I expect. They're just pulled a lot of different directions. I mean, pleasure and sports and all these kind of different things. I mean, the kids are pulled in. It's not just I call it a carnival world, like a circus around there, but it's a contemporary world. They're pulled away. Man alive. Oh yeah. I mean, in the day that we lived, it's just, hey, when it even comes to churches, I mean, somebody just preaching the gospel, laying it out. If we're not careful, brother, man, we got to have this, got to have that. And then all of a sudden, then they're getting pulled away. And they get pulled away from old time preaching. They get pulled away from, because they say, hey, come to church, man, and we'll jam out. Come to church and we'll rock out. And look, I'm just telling you, that I realize the pull of that. But that's another pull that they face. That's the opposition that they face. But the bad thing about it is, it's a counterfeit world. I mean, it's not real, you understand? When we were lost and we were on our way to hell, I started thinking about, you know, what did we do? How were we pulled? Now, I realized the sin that was in our family. I was raised in a drunkard's home and all the mess goes along with it. I preach that all the time, but we were. I mean, my dad went through phases, man. He went through a phase of cowboy hat, boot wearing, you know, all this kind of stuff. I mean, you know, he was going to be like cowboy, you know. He went through the motorcycle phase, you know. Then he wasn't just a cowboy, now on a steel horse he's riding. I mean, it was hilarious. I mean, just for a while. I mean, then that was gone. But what was all that? We went through a farming thing where one summer we went out just this place where we just farm like I don't even know what we did. Amen. We just got hot and dirty and trying to grow some stuff never did grow. Amen. But I mean, you know what? We was just being pulled. Sports, all son. Me and my brothers, we played all the stuff. You know, they take us. That's where we spent. We spent our time. You know, that's where these people spend their time. They don't know. We use that. Hey, I'd love for you to come to church on a Sunday night. That's the foreign. Right. Man, they don't realize. Hey, I'd love for you to come in on a Wednesday night and just hear some of the Word of God. Right? You're about to mess up the schedule. Because, again, hey, counterfeit world. Here's what Satan's doing. Satan says, no, put the priority on this, put it on this, put it on this, put it on this. But, hey, whatever we can do, let's keep their attention off God. Who has to bring their attention to God? Y'all help me. We do. How do you do that? House to house, daily in the temple, and in every house they cease not to teach and preach Jesus Christ. Somebody's got it. Somebody came by our house. They came by with those buses one day, and we were in the middle of all that. I mean, the carnival world. I mean, the contemporary world, the counterfeit world, man pulling us in all these directions, but they came by. And I mean, brother, I tell you what it did. It got my dad and my stepmother's attention. And here they were bringing the bus by, so they said, all right, the boys can ride. We started riding, then Gary got saved. Then in that summer, you know, that's when I got saved. That's when my dad, stepmother, a bunch of them got saved that summer. But it was all because one day this happened. That's all. Just this, hey. Knock at the door. Somebody took their time to come to every house. And they did come down to that, to where we lived. They were turning the bus around, and they did come down there. We were outside, so they came to that house individually, seeing us as children out there. But they visited every house in that neighborhood. We got a load of the kids in that neighborhood to come. We had a big Sunday, and man, they came out there, and me and my brothers, we had 26 people standing at the bus stop. I mean, because, hey, you know what they said? They said, we'll give you a silver dollar for every kid you have if you have the most. I was like, woo, yeah. Hey, I think I spent them silver dollars, but I may have a few of them still left. I don't know. I just know this. I'm saying, imagine if you stopped at one stop, y'all, 26 kids get on at one stop. And I'm telling you, hey, you say, why? Because they took time to do this one day. See, I'm just telling you, somebody took time to go house to house. Somebody, and I don't know about all the other houses. I don't know how they felt about people coming by. I don't know how that affected their life. I don't know what it did in the people up the street's life and all these others. I just know this. I know what happened at the Hopkins house. Man, I know what happened because they took the Bible literally for what it says. You see this opposition, hey, the world, the flesh, the devil I've been preaching on, man, all of that goes against every house, every home. I mean, brother, every dad, every mom. But brother, the goal of the devil is this, keep them people out of church, keep them away from the gospel, keep them on their way to hell, make it so that when they die, they never know about Jesus. We have to step in and make sure that don't happen. We have to do that. You have to do that. I have to do it. You see, that's our responsibility as a church. And I'll just give you this. You see the opposition to these homes, but I turn it around. The next thing is this. How about the opportunity that's in that home? Amen. You see, you know what the opportunity is when we go knocking on doors? The Bible says, and daily in the temple and in every house they cease not to teach and preach Jesus Christ. And then the next verse in chapter 6, and in those days when the number of the disciples was multiplied. Now, how does it multiply like that? Because people are going out in droves. And I'm talking about, hey, every single house, every family telling them about Christ. Preacher, that had to be different. I mean, to them, Jesus was so real. Many of them had seen Jesus. Many of them had met Jesus. I've met him too, and so have you if you're saved. You met him too. He's in your heart. He saved your soul. He changed your life. He's done all of that. Wait a minute now. You've got somebody to tell them about. We've got somebody to tell them about. I'll tell you what, we got to tell them. We got all these flags all over the walls, and I mean, it just they represent countries of the world. I tell you what I do, preacher. I lay some money in that envelope, and I designate it toward missions. And I tell you what, I feel good. I do too. I want to send people all around the world telling everybody about Jesus. But hey, let's don't send people all around the world and reach all of these countries right here when Locust Grove is dying and going to hell. We got to reach them, amen. We got to get a hold of them. We just got to tell them. We can't save one of them. You know that? We can't save them. We can't make them get saved. There's no doubt. Our job is to tell them. Our job is to tell them. And do we just tell some of them? You know, do we just go to some houses? Do we just go to a select few houses? No, we go to every house. Do you just go to the big houses? No. You just go to the small houses? No. You just go to the trailer park? No. You just go to the apartments? No. You go to all of them. Every single one of them. And what do? Every house. Hi, I'm Terrell Hopkins. I'm the pastor down here at Heritage Baptist Church. Man, I was just out in the neighborhood visiting. I'm just going down the street meeting every single family. And I wanted to invite you to Heritage Baptist Church. I'll pull the track out now. I say, oh, I want to invite you to the Heritage Baptist Church, and I'd love for you to come. But more important than that, look on the front of this. Look at what we put on the front of all of these. It says, anyone ever taken a Bible and personally shown you how you can know when you die, you're going to heaven. I don't know if you've ever had anybody tell you that. I don't know if you understand that. And you begin to talk to them. Now, that's just simple. That's just knocking on the door. By the way, you knock on the door. What if they're not home? Why don't we go back? Yeah. Stair family. I can't help it. Proof's in the pudding. Amen. Brother Barry, neighborhood, going door to door. Our goal is give somebody a neighborhood, you meet everybody on it. Give somebody a street, meet everybody on it. If they're not home, go back. If they're not home again, go back. Not home again, go back. You know when you're done with that neighborhood? When you've met every single person and found out about their soul, I'm telling you, then we'll give you another neighborhood. Brother Barry and him, third time through, knock, knock, knock. Brother Gary Stair, hi, I'm Brother Gary Stair. Amen. And then there's Pilar, hi. No. Hi, I'm Pilar Stair. And then all the kids, you know, a lot of them weren't even around then, amen. But some of them were. But you understand, there you got a whole family. Family been in here for years. Hey. Why? Hey. Somebody came. Man, I'm glad somebody came. Hey. I look at many of you. Hey, somebody invited you. Somebody came, maybe they met you here, maybe they met you there, but somebody, hey, came and knocked on your door, many of you. Yeah. And you crossed paths with this church. Now, the opportunity we have is for people to be converted. The opportunity we have is for their life to be changed. And when God changes their life, then all of a sudden you see people begin to commit themselves and begin to come to church. Then you see God begin to work in their life and to call them and to use them, and they're serving God. And you see, that's the opportunity we have. Hey, it's not just a matter of, I knocked on their door, my hands are clean, I'm good. No, I'm not satisfied. My goal is not just how many doors did we knock on. It's not just how many people did tell about Christ. Brother, I want to influence somebody for Christ before I die. I want to influence some more. Now, I've influenced a few. I don't know how many. But I'll tell you this, I don't know how many years, and I don't know how long I've got before I meet Jesus. Amen. Yeah, Brother Keith Lee called today. You know, last Wednesday, we had everybody praying for him. You know, when he went in and had a quadruple bypass. I mean, the man's in his 40s. I mean, like, you know, young, kind of young. Anyway, quadruple bypass, the preacher hat. I'm preaching up there here in a few weeks on a Monday and a Tuesday. It's gonna be good. But his daughter, Megan, man, she had a blood clot, just got married, had some kind of a blood clot, all kind of stuff going on. She's still, they're about to let her out of the hospital. He's out of the hospital, but while he was in there, one of his lungs collapsed. And I just told him, I said, brother, I said, I'm glad I'm getting a call on the fact that you are recovering and doing as good as you are doing instead of forgetting, because he said that day, man, he was working and he felt like something sitting on his chest. He didn't know. He thought it was just hot outside. And thank goodness he went and got it checked out. And they're like, man, every artery you got is clogged, man. Your plumbing is messed up. And so the man ends up, but I think, all right, man, how long has that preacher got? How long did, thank goodness, maybe he's got a few more years now. How long do we have? I told y'all at camp, I'm still cutting up about it. Down there at camp, the younger, the guys were getting up doing all the devotions and everything. And one of them got up and said, now kids, said to Brother Hopkins and Brother Patrick, now these older men of God, they got to have to pass their mantle on. They said they got more years behind them than they got in front of them. They said the funnel's going this way, not this way anymore. I'm getting to feeling a little weak. I'm like, whew, I don't feel so good. Amen. Hey, come on now. You know the reality of it? It's the truth. 49, come on now. You're going to live another. Now, I may live to be 90-something years old. But the way I've eaten, I doubt it. I mean, hey, the math don't add up when I go to thinking about that. Amen. It'd be a miracle of God to live that long. So the truth is, I have more years behind me than I have in front of me. And some of y'all do too. Only one life will soon be passed. Only what's done for Christ will last. Here's what matters. Can't go back and change what I should have done. I can't go back and change what I ought have done. I can't go back and change what I wanted to be. Can't be that. All I have is what's in front of me. Can't go back and change how many doors I should have knocked. I can't go back to 18 years it'll be in January of pastoring a church and say, well, boy, I tell you, how many houses have we knocked on? How many people have we? I can't do that. It don't matter if it's astronomically great. It don't matter, because that's all behind us. What matters right now is here, it matters that I'm preaching this tonight because the Lord's stirring my heart so much on it. And hopefully it's stirring yours. Because this matter of reaching people is paramount. Got more years behind me than I got in front of me. The funnel's going that way, not that way. Brother, amen. Well, hey, then if it's so narrowing down, then shouldn't I be doing more now than I've ever done? If it's going that way, then what should I be spending my time on? To me, reaching people is the most. I mean, we're going after the people that the Son of God died for. Jesus died for every precious soul that lives in Locust Grove, lives in McDonough, lives in Griffin, lives in Jackson, lives in Stockbridge. He died for every precious soul. And here's what the occupants of those homes, their souls there, the offspring, that's the children, the opposition, we understand that. The opportunity, boy, it's great. But what is our obligation? What's our biblical obligation? What's the Bible tell us? That's really what it boils down to. Jesus has died on Calvary. He has risen from the grave. He has showed himself to above 500 at once. He showed himself to the crowd on the Emmaus Road, to the disciples, and now he's showing himself to the disciples again. Look in Matthew chapter 28. He is getting ready to rise into heaven. I mean, brother, he's going to be there until he comes back, brother, to get us when he comes again. Amen. I'm telling you, brother, he's not visiting in between, you understand? So Jesus is getting ready to be gone, to rise and to be gone. And the Bible says in Matthew, this is what Jesus says to those disciples. And I say this, if you're saved, you're a disciple right now, you're born again, and the Son of God, hey, the words that echoed in their ears, it ought to echo in our ears, amen. And here's what he said. Jesus told them in Matthew chapter 28, and in verse 18, he said, And Jesus came and spake unto them, saying, all power is given unto me in heaven and in earth. Go ye therefore and teach all nations. Teach them what? Teach them Jesus loved them, died for them. Teach them they're a sinner on their way to hell. Teach them they can't get to heaven on their own. Teach them that without a shadow of a doubt that the Son of God loved them and has made it possible for them to have eternal life, for their sins to be forgiven, for them to have a good standing with God. Go you therefore and teach all nations. What happens after they trust Christ? Baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, the Holy Ghost. What do you do after that? What we're doing tonight, teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I've commanded you. Man, that all things, that's a lot of things. You know, some people, they just like certain things. You know, preacher, just preach on them certain things, them things I like, them things I'm doing. Well, the preacher has to preach on all of it. He said, teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I've commanded you, and lo, I am with you alway, even unto the end of the world. Amen. You're there in that's the command in Matthew chapter 28. Go ye, go ye. And what do? We see what they did in the book of Acts. The Bible says daily in the temple and in every house, they cease not to teach and preach Jesus Christ. You know what they're doing? Fulfilling the commission. They're obeying Jesus Christ. They're obeying what the Son of God, the last words of the Son of God when he rose into heaven was the commission for me and you to go after others that don't know him. The last thing you tell somebody when you're leaving to go on vacation, I mean, the last words that come out of your mouth are the most important, aren't they? Please don't forget to lock this. Please don't forget to cut that off. Please don't forget to do this. Well, Jesus, when he's getting ready to leave, says, go ye, therefore, and teach all nations. In Mark, he said, Mark is very similar. Mark ends up in Mark chapter 16 and verse 15. And he said unto them, go ye into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. Every creature needs a preacher. Then, by the way, in Acts chapter 1 and verse 8, we were in Acts chapter 5, but in Acts chapter 1 and verse 8, he's reminding them about the power that they have to do this in. It's not their own power, it's the power of the Holy Spirit of God. The Bible says in Acts chapter 1 and verse 8, he said, but ye shall receive power. After that, the Holy Ghost has come upon you. By the way, what's evidence of being filled with the Holy Ghost? Well, I'll tell you what, here's the evidence. Well, what does the Bible say? And it says, but ye shall receive power. After that, the Holy Ghost is come upon you, and ye shall be witnesses unto me. Yep. Somebody's filled with the Holy Ghost, they'll be a soul winner. They'll tell people about Jesus. They'll knock on doors. They'll go to every house. Why? Because that's what the Lord said they'd do. He said, but you shall receive power. After that, the Holy Ghost has come upon you, and you shall be witnesses unto me. Both, in other words, at the same time, in Jerusalem, and in all Judea, and in Samaria, and in the uttermost part of the earth. Jerusalem, that's your house, that's your family. Judea, that's your hometown. That's the people you cross paths with over at Ingles, over at Walmart, that you see on a regular basis. Then he said, in Samaria, that's the hated. That's people you would not normally go to. That's the crowd you wouldn't normally hang around with. God says, you're responsible to tell them too. And then he says, under the uttermost part of the earth, there's the heathen. That's us supporting missions and sending missionaries all over this world, all over the United States, wherever we can send them. So see, that's the command. He tells us where to go. He tells us about the power, the people, and he tells us about our purpose, and you shall be witnesses unto me in that one verse. Then, of course, in the book of Acts, I've already given you many of those verses, but we stop here in chapter 5 and verse 42. And he says, and daily in the temple and in every house they cease not to teach and preach Jesus Christ. You know, it's a personal responsibility, this matter of telling people about Jesus. Romans, we use Romans in Romans chapter 10, verse 13. That's the last verse when we're given the Romans road, right? For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. And we all know that. We memorize that verse. But here, notice what it says after that. In Romans chapter 10 and verse 14, how then shall they call on him in whom they have not believed? And how shall they believe on him in whom they have not heard? And how shall they hear without a preacher? You see, and how shall they preach except they be sent? As is written, how beautiful are the feet of them that preach the gospel of peace and bring glad tidings of good things. But they have not all obeyed the gospel. But for Isaiah said, Lord, who hath believed our report? So here it is in verse 17. So then faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. How does somebody get saved? They got to hear. If you go backwards with what I just read, he said, somebody's got to preach. And when you preach, they can hear. When they hear, they can believe. When they believe, they can call. They call on the Lord and they get saved. But it's a step. And again, then verse 17, so then faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. How are they going to hear? Unless we tell them. It's our responsibility. Now, we've got days where we go visiting. We've got different, I understand that. We go out on Saturday. We go Saturday morning at 10. That's just a time we have designated, a good time to say, hey, church, here's a time where we as a church will meet together. We can organize. We have certain places to go. We have people to see. You can come to the church. You can be paired with somebody that can do the talking. It's a good time to come and to say, all right, then I want to obey that. I want to do that. I want to fulfill this matter of go ye into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. I want to fulfill that. Go ye therefore and teach all nations. Amen. Then I want to be witnesses unto him. I want to tell people about the Lord. I want to be a witness. I want to be what God wants me to be. I don't want people to die and go to hell. I don't want to ride by houses and say, that's a pretty house. I want to ride by a house and say, man, that house is full of souls. There's souls in that house. And I don't want to be satisfied to say, boy, there's souls there. Somebody needs to reach them. I want to, in my own heart, say, all right, Lord, then help me. And from this day forward, to say, by the grace of God, then this matter, what's the method? We know the message. The message is Christ. They're sinners. They can't get to heaven on their own. They got to die and go to hell to pay for their sins. But Christ loved them. Christ died for them. Christ rose from the dead. And brother, they can put their faith in Jesus Christ, their faith in the Son of God, and he can forgive their sin and save their soul. Amen. So we got the message. We have the message. And God gives us the method. And from house to house, daily in the temple and in every house, there's the method. You and I going out and telling them. Let me ask you, who's the messenger? Who's the messenger? That's us. Nobody else. Can't put that on anybody else, can you, when you really look at it like that? Man, the Lord lays it in our lap. I just say this then, all right? As a church, Heritage Baptist Church, then we've got a responsibility to reach people that are dying and going to hell. How are we going to do it? Got to go to every house. We got to do it methodically. Got to do it, I mean, religiously. I mean, just continuously. I mean, steadfastly. But can I just say, we don't have all eternity to do it. Have to do it now. There's got to be some kind of an urgency. That means you got to set aside a time to do that. Preacher, I can't go on Saturday morning at 10. There's no way. Now, I understand the can't go. What I have a hard time with is the won't go. You know. So I say, if you say, I can't go then, that's fine. How many houses are on your street? Who lives there? You're responsible for those souls. Then great. Then whatever day, you can go a little while before Wednesday night service, go. You can go a little while on Thursday, go. You can go a little while on Friday, go. You can go on Monday or a Tuesday or a Saturday, Sunday afternoon between church. If that's where you can go, go. But knock on, hey, every house. And I just say, as a church, we've got maps, we map this stuff out and we go. And here's what we have. We have a few people that go. And we have put a small dent in this area. There has been a time, I mean, since we've been down here, of course, we have knocked on every single door in Locust Grove. We've knocked on every many, many thousands of doors. I understand that. But I can't step back and say, I knocked on that door one time, how long, 10 years ago? I can wash my hands. Who lives there now? The children that were little kids then, are they old enough to understand now? Don't I need to go back and talk to the family again? Tell them about Christ. In fact, I don't know that this job of telling people about Christ ever gets over with. I think the Lord's given us a full-time job till the day we meet Jesus. Woo! Man! We have opportunity. they can get saved. Their lives can be changed. God, and you talk about God blessing a place for doing it. Let everybody in this church get in their heart this thing of, I tell you what I'll do. I'll do this. And by the way, this is not, who knocked on the most door? No, I'll take a Brother McDonald coming like he does, and he'll come and hey, Brother Hopkins. Hey, he ain't bouncing like he used to bounce, all right? He ain't running as fast. He's jumping, but not high. I understand that. But he comes. You know what he'll do? He'll knock on doors. He's got something to tell, don't you, brother? Oh, yeah. He's got something to tell. I got something to tell, man. Don't you have something to tell? What's he done for you? So I say, church, here, we've got Saturday morning. We're going to be here at 10. We got those, who was it? That crowd's coming in. They're coming in on, they're going to be Saturday, so they're going to be with us on Sunday, that college group. But they're coming in on Friday. They need to come Friday because they're just getting here a little bit early. And so we got the house occupied, so we're getting them a couple of hotel rooms, you know. So we're going to do that. But my only prerequisite was, hey, you will come. Y'all stay there Friday night. Y'all be here at 10 o'clock Sunday or Saturday morning. You know what? They're going out with us. They're knocking on doors with us. Amen. Preacher, they ought to. You're paying for a room for them. They ought to come and go visit it. Hey, Jesus paid for your soul on Calvary. Top dollar. Boom. What you doing Saturday? Bow your head and close your eyes. Why don't we commit as a church that we'll reach this community?
Thank you for choosing to watch this sermon preached at Heritage Baptist Church. Heritage Baptist Church is located at 1843 Peaksville Road, Locust Grove, Georgia, 30248. You can contact us at 770-320-7771. Visit us on the web at www.hbcga.com.